So, first and foremost, a very generous gratitude from my side towards International Copper Association on inviting me to speak on this topic. Many thanks to Amol, Devdas, you could not join, for allowing me to present some of my views on this topic of KVH billing, which has been something that I would say it's like a shift which has occurred in the Indian state utilities over the last 10 to 12 years. And the gradual shift has been more and more pervasive now across more and more states in the country. And I think it's only apt that we keep on having such educational awareness campaigns to educate industries, facilities, SMEs to understand what does it mean for them and how they can make the most out of the shift from the KWH to the KVH billing that has occurred. So once again, thank you. And I will directly get into the agenda for today. What are we going to cover for today's session? Essentially, what we'll have is very quickly, as Amolji pointed out, the traditional power triangle, which we have learned in school, in college, that's something engineering which we'll just very quickly go through and what changes it does entail now with the new age introduction of various kind of non-linear loads and so on and so forth. Then we'll dive into KVH billing, the why did it occur, and what does it comprise of, what are the essential ingredients of KVH billing. Further on, what kind of load types, and their impacts on KVH billing, what kind of load types you might expect to have within your premise, within your plant or your building or your facility, and what can you expect the impacts on due to those on KVH billing. Furthermore, we will find out what changes in the power triangle have now occurred as a result of this new age penetration of so-called non-linear loads that we see everywhere around us. And lastly, and most importantly, how do we get on top of ensuring that we are maximizing our efficiency with respect to our energy bills, and what are the ways and means, what approach you can take, a step-by-step approach we will go through, which can help you to take the control of your energy optimization in your own hands. And hopefully that gives you some takeaways to take from this webinar. I know it will be really great for us if some of you are able to take some actions as a result of this and do save money out of this, which is in turn, carbon savings. And the more and more we know our planet, our Earth needs that to be done, the more and more climate change events we've been watching all around us with increasing frequency. The more we can do, whatever small part we can play, we'll be really thankful. So let's get into the meat of the matter. What is all this brouhaha about? So going back to electrical engineering 101, or I would say reactive power 101, very simply, we know that there is energy which your machines, your loads, etc., they need to consume to work. They need power. So essentially, whenever you have an energy input which is given or taken by any machine or any motor or any kind of load, there is a certain element of work that needs to be done, right? Which needs to be done, and that essentially is an work that is the work that the machine or the load needs to be doing for it. But at the same time, there is a certain additional lossy work which also gets done, like which is lost in the form of reactive power, if we call it. And that is something which is a magnetizing current, you can call it. It is the non-active part of the power triangle, which is something that you have to provide to that load for it to function properly. And ideally, what we want to do is that whatever energy we are inputting to our plant, whatever energy we are taking from the generator, we want to 100% utilize it. And ideally, we want that that KVRH or the reactive power component to be essentially zero. So let's go into the power triangle, right? What are we talking about here? And we have all been exposed, or we have all been, I would say, you know, very much familiar with the beer analogy at some point, if I'm not wrong, with respect to how it mirrors the concept of the reactive power or the power triangle, you know, philosophy. So you see on the screen where you have your power, you have your sorry, your reactive power, your active power, and the hypotenuse comprises of the apparent power. In a sense, if you talk in terms of the coffee mug or the coffee mug that you have over here, the actual coffee which is being consumed, right, that you are going to be drinking is the active power, and the one that is being not being actually used is the froth, which almost is like imaginary. It's almost like made out of bubbles, which is useless in a way in terms of the occupation of the whole cup. It is occupying a big chunk of the cup, but then it is not going to be really satisfying your need. So, but you get the whole thing. When you ask for a coffee, you get the whole thing, irrespective of whether you ask for it or not. So that's what is the original power triangle, which we understand as it is. And our endeavor, as I said earlier, is always to ensure that the real power and the apparent power are equal, as equal to themselves, are as equal, so that the reactive power, which has two components, it can have the reactive power component can be either inductive or it can be capacitive, right? Both of these can be possible depending on the kind of loads that you have in your system, and you ideally want them to be zero, so that your full utilization of your input power can be done to your output power. Now, while I'm talking about input and output, let's just go back a little 40,000 feet above and try to understand the journey from generation to the consumer of energy across various actors, if I would say. At this point, I should thank APQI's partner, Mr. Tushar Mogre. I've used quite a few of his slides in his presentation, and this is one such example. So what you're seeing here is that what are the different actors that are needed to get the energy from the generator? Okay, generators today are very many. It is not only the thermal power plants or the utilities generating stations. It is the consumer himself is also a generator if he's having a solar rooftop power within his facility, or if it is a windmill which is situated by some state at their windmill farms or something. So that is the generation side, which either needs certain fuel in the in form of actual fuel in the form of diesels or something, some such fuels, or it can be sunlight, wind, or anything. Further on, it needs to be transmitted, right? And then it needs to be distributed, and further on, it needs to be reaching the final consumer where the metering or the billing occurs. So what are the different roles that are being played, or what are the different ingredients? So you have the fuel cost, which is one part that goes as part of your energy cost or the unit energy that you pay. There is a generation cost, right? The cost of generating every unit of energy that you are consuming. Then there is a transmission cost of getting it from those generators which are situated at various parts of the country, transmitting it over high voltage lines and getting it to the state's distribution system. So that's where the distribution comes in place, which is in a way the just the last mile distribution from where you are going to get the power finally to your plant, to your facility. And all of this has to have certain infrastructure to be continuously upgraded and worked upon and invested in, capital investment which has to be done. So if we look at it, the fuel cost and the generation cost, right, these two in a way are the ones which are responsible for your energy consumption. Okay, it is kWh energy, the unit that you are actually consuming in a way. So these are the two main things which are responsible. You further go on and you understand that the distribution cost is something which is the part that needs to be used or transmitted to you, and there are certain losses in that. There is a lot of transmission loss, there's a lot of distribution loss. This is where all the reactive power loss and all of these losses come in, which till now, in a way, wherever states have still in KWH, you know, like Gujarat or Madhya Pradesh, where still KWH billing exists, they are covered in the form of power factor penalties or incentives, which is a thing of the past, for example, in Maharashtra, which was there you know, prior to April 2020 and so on. So this distribution cost is covered in some states in the form of PF penalties or incentives. Further on, the infrastructure cost, right, of all these three actors of generation, distribution and transmission, all of them put together is the demand cost that you pay. It is the fixed cost of your energy bill that you are supposed to pay to the utility company. And this is what holds today even for both KWH as well as KVH kind of consumers. And so when we talk about a KVH billing, what happens is the KVH billing essentially is now subsuming or it's encompassing both your metering, the KWH components which are responsible, and the PF penalty incentives, that is the distribution cost which is incurred by the utility to transmit the power, reach, make the power reach to your particular plant or facility. So that's in a very high level nutshell the journey of power and how KWH and KVH is differentiated. If you look at it from the point of view of simple energy under the curve, what we had earlier is KWH, which is your KW into time, right? So your active power into time is equal to your number of units that you are consuming. So 1 kilowatt of power that you consume, if you consume it for 1 hour, 1 kilowatt, if you consume it for 1 hour, is equal to 1 unit of KWH, 1 unit of consumption. So all that is now done is, instead of that 1 kWh, it has now become KVA. And it's 1 kVA into 1 hour becomes your 1 kVH of unit consumption, right? So that's a very basic difference between what KWH and KVH is. So further on to the factors, right, which affect this KVH billing as opposed to KWH billing, which we will be talking about in more detail, but just to see here. First is that you find is that there are the substantial T&D losses, which we spoke about, of these power for being transmitted from the generation to transmission to distribution and to you. So due to a poor power factor, due to a leading or lagging, and as well as harmonics, right? This is one of the reasons why the shift was thought of to be made from KWH to KVH, because the consumer was not in a way paying for these in a very fair sense. It was not being accounted for properly. The power factor was not being properly monitored. It was not being properly attended to. It was not being mitigated, or it was not being improved upon. Similarly, harmonics, as and when the loads have started becoming non-linear in nature. You know, if I spend just a minute here to talk about what is non-linear, anything and everything that has to do with AC to DC conversion, anything and everything that has to do with rectification, right? Be it your as simple as your mobile charger, which you use, or as complex as a variable frequency drive or LED light for that matter. All of these have the components of rectification. All of these are doing some sort of conversion of power. And all of these bring into the electrical system what we call as non-fundamental components. So you have the fundamental 50 hertz component, and you have the non-fundamental integer multiples of 50 hertz. So you have a 50 into 3, that's a 150 hertz. You have a 50 into 5, that's a 150 hertz, and so on. So these are all your multiples of your fundamental frequency, which are comprised of your harmonics in your system. So all of these were essentially now have started increasing more and more in the entire electric grid, and causing more and more losses to the system, causing more and more overloading, aging of infrastructure, which the utilities have to maintain. So that's one big reason why the shift was thought of. Second reason, if you would say, is the ambiguity in a way, because the utilities were giving, if you remember in Maharashtra, there was a 7% incentive which was given for maintaining a unity power factor. Now, in hindsight, if we see, there was no concept of leading power factor. There was no concept of understanding whether an export of reactive power energy was happening or not, or it was import only. And people used to continuously put their capacitor banks on, irrespective of whether it went into substantial leading zone or not. And they used to get the 7% incentive. Now, this obviously was a loss to the utility, no doubt about it, in terms of revenue loss or in terms of all of that. But as a, if you look at it in total, it was a significant amount of energy loss that we were doing at a nation's level. You know, we were not really managing the flow of power or managing the flow of energy as optimum it should have been. So KVH allows us to do that. Similarly, one audit in one of the discounts in Maharashtra, it revealed that almost 63% of consumers, okay, they were almost overcompensating, which means that they were, the very fact that I mentioned, they were having capacitor panels, or they were having reactive power energy compensation panels, having much more than what actually they required. And out of this, 80% of them were facing resonance, or they were having resonance in the system, which means amplification of harmonics was happening in their particular plant or facility, which meant that they were also magnifying harmonics while they were trying to improve their power factor, because these two have a very strong relation, which we will see in the next few slides. So that was another big reason why the shift happened. Fourth is system infrastructure maintenance and upkeep. You can expect a lot of losses, as I mentioned. KV capacity used to get blocked because people were not mindful about controlling their demand, about controlling their energy, because there was no, very direct, impact apart from the power factor incentive or penalty. Some states even today, they do not have any incentive, nor do they have any penalty even till the consumer goes below 0.9. So 0.9 and above, if you're maintaining a power factor, you are going to be not being penalized, nor are you going to be incentivized for doing anything. So that has a potential to improve your energy efficiency if you can go all the way up to 0.98 or 99, which is a good zone to operate in. And lastly, and most importantly, the shift, in our opinion, is to give you control to the consumers, to control their energy consumption completely. So that's the reason why a simpler method of billing was needed. So let's go further and understand the different components of a KVH billing, which even holds true for KWH for the three main components. You have fixed charges, your statutory charges, and your variable charges, right? The fixed charges we spoke about are something which the utility needs to cover all its infrastructure for, all the overhead, the asset depreciation cost, and it is generally proportional to your contract demand. These are how the fixed charges are being billed to you. The statutory charges, in a way, are your taxes, duties, your late payment charges, mostly which are all proportional to the energy consumption that you are doing. And the variable, obviously, as the name says, these are variable in nature based on the energy that you consume. These can be not only energy charges, this can be wheeling charges, it can be FAC, TOD, incentives, electricity duty, and so on, which are all proportional to the energy consumption in either KWH or KVH. Okay. And if you look at the list of things which you would commonly read in an energy bill, the poll showed that almost 89% of participants do understand their energy bill, which is a very heartening figure to know. So I won't go into too much detail into this, but just that the ones in green, which you see over here, are the ones that are typically used by are something which you can use to control your energy bill. These are the ones which are under your control. You can control your demand, you can control your energy, you can have control over your power factor incentives or discounts, obviously. That's very obvious. But the ones in red typically are not in the control of the consumer, like your UT, FSC, bulk discounts, incremental discounts, and so on and so forth. So let's get into what are the different loads, which allow us to have an impact on KVH billing. What are the different kinds of loads that will change the way in which your KVH billing will occur, or it will impact significantly your bill increase or decrease? In a way, how will your bill behave? So first and foremost is highly inductive or capacitive loads. So whenever you have loads which are having a very poor power factor, it can be either leading or lagging. It can be a pure inductive load, or it can be a load which is having a, in today's scenario, there are a lot of loads like UPSs or SMPSs, which are already throwing leading power factor into the grid. So if you have, if for example, your facility is like an IT facility, which is having a lot of LEDs, which is having a lot of unity connected supplies, power supplies, a lot of UPSs, which are running at a much lower load capacity than their actual full load capacity, then what happens is you are subjected to a leading power factor inside your facility. And that also is going to increase the consumption of kVAH that you are going to observe within the facility, or if it's purely inductive loads which you are having in your facility, or harmonics. So that we'll see how that affects. But highly inductive or capacitive loads, these in itself are going to cause you one big reason why kVAH billing is going to get affected. The next is continuously variable load. Okay, the loading, electrical loading that is continuously variable in nature. Like more abrupt the variations, more abrupt the load variations, the impact is adverse. So let's see how what we mean by continuously variable load and how it can affect our kVAH billing, so as to speak. So what you see in this slide is that we are having a certain time cycle. Okay, at one point in time or at one cycle, there is a certain amount of the power triangle which you're seeing over here. You have a certain amount of active power, you have a certain amount of reactive power, and subsequently the kVA being computed, right? That's one time cycle. Then you have a next time cycle where it's slightly varying because the load is varying. Your load, your plant is varying. Maybe it's a rolling mill, maybe it's a automotive factory, it's induction arc furnace, where the performance of the furnace, depending on that, it's the loads are varying significantly. You have multiple different time cycles where suddenly the load increases by a huge amount. Suddenly there is a maybe a an export of reactive power is also happening, as opposed to import of reactive power always. And which you see over here in terms of the negative zone, where the second quadrant, sorry, fourth quadrant, where the reactive energy is being shown, where it is being exported in a way. So you have multiple time cycles, and all of these are having different loads which are coming as part of your energy consumption. So if you see the overall power triangle, what you see is there is a difference in terms of the final kVA at different points in time, which is occurring. But if it was the earlier method by which kVAH was consumed, okay, then typically what would happen is the sum of all your kWh and kVRH would, the sum square root of that would be what your kVAH be calculated as. And you would be seeing the blue line, which will be your kVAH that you will be having as part of your energy bill, although you are not being billed for it. But today, with the difference in computations of kVAH done by a lot of utilities, what will happen effectively is your kVAH, which is calculated by the meter, okay, will be something which you're seeing as a green line. And you can see that automatically your kVAH by the metering is going to be higher than the kVAH calculated using the simple sum square root or the Pythagoras method as we know it, right? So there obviously is a lot of I would say effort yet to be taken by utilities to educate in terms of the various computational algorithms that they use to compute kVAH energy. But typically these are done on either sliding interval method or fixed time blocks of 30 minutes or so, and the aggregation is done. For maximum demand, it can be a 15-minute or a 30-minute duration, where the peak maximum demand which has gone is calculated, and the energy consumed under the curve, which I showed earlier, is something which is calculated every 30 minutes and aggregated. Typically, that's just an example I'm giving you. But as I said, what is happening now is your kVAH is being calculated at every cycle instead of doing it and aggregate as far as the sum square root between kWh and kVAH is concerned. So abruptly changing loads are going to have that small delta in terms of the difference between the metering and the calculated kVAH. All right. Now we go further to understanding similar situation, but with respect to unbalanced loads. Right. That's the next element in terms of the different load types that you can experience in different industries. You might have single-phase loads. You might have two-phase welding loads. You might have loads which are having different kinds of behavior, right? You might have a lighting, you might have a single-phase motor loads inside your facility, and so on and so forth. So you have each phase having different vectorial representation, each phase having different consumption in terms of the KW and KVR. And hence, effectively, obviously, the KVA vector will change. So you have different differences in all of these three. And what again you see over here in the vector diagram is that originally, if at all you had your traditional method of computation, it would have been simply the sum of all these KWs and your KVRs and having your sum square root to give you a calculated KVA. But with the difference in billing, whereby each phase is computed individually, what would happen is you would have a slightly higher delta in terms of your KVA consumption, and your, because your metered KVA is going to be the sum of your individual calculated KVA vectors, individually calculated hypotenuses of each Pythagoras based on the Pythagoras theorem that we know. So that's something that you need to keep in mind. Even if you have a significantly unbalanced loading, it's going to affect your KVA calculation, right? So that's the second third type of load that we spoke about. And the last and the most, I would say, crucial type of loading that we are talking about is in terms of your harmonics, is the effect of harmonics on KVH billing. What kind of effect does it have? So when you see this, again, your simple two-dimensional vector diagram representation of your active current, which is your on the x-axis, and your reactive current on the y-axis, these are your fundamental components. So what I mentioned earlier, it is your simply your 50 hertz component that you are monitoring, and a 50 hertz component for which you are paying, and the 50 hertz reactive component for which you were compensating till now. You were compensating the power factor for the 50 hertz fundamental component. But if we go further and we do find out what is the existing current, okay, that's your fundamental current, which is your apparent, your total current, which is a sum square root of your active and your reactive current for the fundamental components. And this we would call it in a way your fundamental current plane, okay, your reactive current fundamental, or the fundamental plane, which is the xy axis. And your power factor over here is simply what you see over here is your five, your angle five, and your cos theta gives your power factor, which is your active current fundamental divided by your apparent power, which is your total your total current but fundamental only. So this is your displacement power factor, right, which is only looking at the 50 hertz fundamental component. And this is what typically we were, when I mentioned earlier consumers putting capacitors more and more to achieve unity power factor, plane capacitors, so as to speak, what essentially was being done is those consumers were improving the displacement power factor, because those capacitors were primarily concerned only with the 50 hertz component, and that's your displacement power factor as we call it. But now, with the introduction of all these nonlinear loads, there is this third dimension of your distortion current which comes into the picture, and that's what is essentially your harmonics. And we can call it as your distortion current plane, which is coming over here. It's your XZ axis plane, if you would call it. And what you see is this distortion current, your harmonic distortion current, that coupled with your active fundamental current gives rise to your active harmonic component. So your harmonics is also responsible for drawing a certain amount of active current, which is what you're seeing in this harmonic distortion, your distortion current plane, right? That's the XZ axis plane, what you're seeing over here. And then going further, what you find is there is a distortion current plane on the YZ axis plane also, which is the component of your reactive current, okay? But both for the fundamental frequencies and your non-fundamental frequencies. So all of both of these put together gives rise to your reactive current, which is your sum effect of all your fundamental and your non-fundamental frequencies put together. So you have your reactive current, which is your now comprised of both harmonic and non-harmonic currents, and you have your active current, which is comprised of both your fundamental and your harmonic currents. So what this gives rise to essentially is your final resultant current, which is in a way your sum square root of not only your active fundamental and your reactive fundamental, but also your harmonic current together. So all these three put together, you find, is going to be higher than your original apparent current of the fundamental frequency, which was expected. And hence your power factor, which you can expect now to have, which is going to be there, is going to be your RMS power factor. We call it, we can call it as a true power factor, which is your ratio of your active current, which is of your comprising of your harmonics and your fundamental frequencies, divided by your apparent current, which is comprised of both the harmonic and the fundamental components. And hence, this will be always be lower than your original displacement power factor, which is only the fundamental frequency components. So summarizing this effect, if you see over here in this simplified power vector, if I represent it now, because finally we want to calculate power factor, this is your fundamental components, your KWs and your KVERs and the KVAF, your fundamentals components, and you have your cos phi, which is your displacement power factor. On top of it, harmonics gets added. And in one typical AC cycle, what you see over here is your KVRH, your KWH, giving rise to your KVAH. That's your harmonic KVA, your harmonic apparent power, which is the consumption they are going to have in every AC cycle. Remember it. Every AC cycle, this consumption is going to add up. It's going to add up, get summed up, and going to be coming up as aggregation into your energy bill. That further being added into the KW is going to then give you that blue line, which is your KW total, and at the same time your KVR, which is your harmonic component, and you find your KVR total coming in, and finally this gives rise to your apparent KVA, which is your harmonic KVA, and your total apparent power, which is your final, as a result of your a phase angle between the I would call it the power, which is a resultant of your all the harmonic and non-harmonic integers components, and your reactive power, which is a component of both your harmonic and non-harmonic components. So you have your apparent power total, which is going to be higher as you view on the screen as compared to your fundamental apparent power on the screen, which is a red versus the blue line that you're seeing, because the KVAH, that's the delta that is adding, that is the harmonic component of apparent power that is getting added up to your fundamental component and giving you your total apparent KVA power. So essentially we know that your fundamental apparent power is always going to be lesser than your total apparent power as a composition of both harmonics and non-harmonic components. So coming back to your power factor cappuccino, if I would say, what you have is, earlier you had only the coffee and the froth, right, which we mentioned is something that you are going to be having in your cup. But the harmonic component is something which is, what is the spillover, which is going to spill over, and it is comprising in a way both KW and KVR in the spillover. And hence your apparent power is comprised of not only just the reactive power and the real power, but also the harmonics power inside your premises, inside your facility. And that in a way is providing you the sum and substance of what harmonics can bring to your facility, how it can increase or enhance your KVH consumption, and why we need to take action against that. So let's go back and understand how we can take this into account, and finally what actions we need to take to optimize this particular KVH billing if you want to optimize it. Let's summarize now. What have we learned so far? KVH energy, as we know it, is a combination of six different factors, if I would summarize in a way so that we can take this as a learning forward. One, loads and their nature. Okay, unbalanced loads, fast changing loads, what percentage of your loads is linear versus non-linear, do you really have reactive energy guzzlers, if we call it that way, huge compressor loads or huge motors which are really consuming a lot of reactive energy, and that can pull your KVH consumption, push your KVH consumption much higher. Second is, big aspect as you now realize is how the combined effect of all of these loads finally manifests at the point of your metering is your reactive energy, right? Which being managed well, if you manage it well, so that your supply versus demand curve is being kept steady at every minute or at every second too. So that's a crucial factor, second factor. The third is performance of reactive power compensation systems that you already have installed or you're planning to buy. Okay, a big role to maintain the factor number two is whether your capacitors are fixed or automatic. Are they detuned or normal? We will speak about that in a bit. Contactor, thyristor, fast switching, slow switching. Is the resolution in line with your load and reactive energy needs or so on? Is it responding fast enough to your load requirements or not? Further on, severity, right? What about the severity of harmonics due to the nature of the load? So as we said, the power triangle is now 3D, three dimensions instead of two dimensions. So the higher the harmonics, higher is the reactive energy, higher is the kVH billing that you will have. And also varying load patterns and distributed energy resources, which also play a significant role. How does your load behave during the daytime versus nighttime? How does your load behave during weekday versus weekend? What about seasonal variations? More importantly, a result of distributed energy resources like PV, solar, there is a level of added complexity, okay, which I would take a moment to explain. A simple example, if you have a rooftop solar installed in your plant, okay, and you know that a rooftop solar plant in a way is only responsible for giving you active power. If the rooftop solar plant is not designed or not configured in a way to give reactive power supply support also, then what will happen is the PV solar is in a way very selfish. It's going to be supplying the useful energy that your loads are requiring, but it doesn't care about the non-active or the reactive energy. So where do you go for satisfying your needs for reactive power? To the good old grid, you know, to the good old MSEDCL or wherever your utility company is. And as you understand, the kVH energy will take a hammering because of that draw of extra reactive power from your grid. So these are some of the factors we need to keep in mind before we go to our next section, where we are going to talk about how to get on top of this energy imbroglio or kVH energy consumption, how to optimize it, what are the ways and means that we can have in our arsenal to optimize it. So again, to draw benefits from kVH energy, okay, I would provide a six-step approach, which in a way allows any plant or facility engineer to take things in his own hand, rather than being dependent on anybody, external agency, dependent on a consultant or OEM or whoever to come and solve or improvise his energy consumption as a result of the factors that we spoke about earlier. So these six factors, we'll go into a little more detail into each one of them. Very quickly, first one, avoiding hasty actions, planning properly. Second is doing an in-depth electricity bill analysis. Third is analyzing your own data about your own systems that you have installed already. You might have a SCADA, you might have a BMS, you might have an energy management system installed, or you might have a power quality monitor, even better, installed in a facility. Fourth is, if not, going for a comprehensive monitoring strategy. Fifth is accurate solutioning, accurate application engineering to come at the right solution, especially being vendor or technology neutral approach, that is very important. And last is, once the solution is installed, how to ensure that it performs in the manner that it was supposed to perform. So if we take up the first step, okay, that's avoiding haste or avoiding band-aids, okay, believe it or not, this is actually in my mind, in my experience of the last 20 years, and also as a result of a lot of the so-called gurus, management gurus or consultants who have given us advice. If you have to cut a tree, you know, we say that, and you have an axe given to you, you should, and if it's going to take you like 8 hours, you should spend almost 4 to 6 hours sharpening the axe and just 2 hours in cutting the tree. So this in a way mirrors that approach, where we need to really understand and factor all the variables which are affecting your plant operations. Or your bills which are going to get affected in the future, you know, such as any changes which are planned in your system, any expansions that you're going to have. Are you planning to integrate renewables in the near future? Are you taking stock of your existing arsenal? You know, what is the status of your existing power factor compensation system? What are the systems which are optimizing kVH today? What are your key load signatures? You know, how is the load signature there? Do you have a two-phase load? Do you have single phase? Most of them are three phase, or how are they? Do you have monitoring systems in place? Is it existent? Is it manual through meter readings by your technicians being done every day, or it is just the end of the month when the bill comes? You know, or is it through SCADA? You know, available to you in your inbox every day, beautiful. But are you doing something about it? So this is something which I call about trying to sharpen the axe before actual action is taken. It doesn't take a lot of time, but it's just that we need to be conscious, aware about this step before we dive into it. The next and the most crucial step, I would say, and you know, is the analysis of past 12 months of your electricity bills, because they present a gold mine of data, right, in your bills. And it's such a powerful tool sitting in the hands of every facility engineer, every manager, in case they choose to dive into it. Because more and more, you know, these changes are happening, regulatory changes, tariff changes, net metering, gross metering, there are so many different concepts, KWs to KVH, and all these shifts are happening. More and more, we need to be on top of understanding our electricity bills. So whether we are understanding what is being levied to us, what are the different factors which are part of our energy bill, whether, you know, we are being charged for our contract demand, or we are being charged for you know, a percentage of contract demand, or whatever actual demand we are consuming, what are the potential losses that we are facing, as opposed to an optimal figure that we should be having in terms of KVH or KVRH consumption. So as well as other factors of billing, you know, discount factors. There are certain states they give incremental discount, right, where you, after a certain number of units which you consume, you are eligible for getting a certain rebate in terms of maybe some paisa per KWH and so on, KVH or so on. So that's the angle of electricity bill analysis. So I will take an example here of one case which with the help of certain tools that we use can provide you a very deep insight. Okay, so before that, we'll just look at this bill in a little detail. So what you see on the screen is a sample of a simple electricity bill, okay, which is from a consumer in Maharashtra, a small consumer, not a very big consumer, about 100 kVA demand, so as to speak. What you see is the one that is circled is your energy consumption, that's your KWH, which is being metered, but it is not being billed today because the shift has happened from KWH to KVH. The next is your KVRH and your power factor, right, which you see over here, and abysmally low. If you can see your power factor, almost at a 0.846, which is almost at the tune of below 0.9, which ideally should have given a penalty in the earlier days before KVH billing. But because the penalties or incentives have been removed, this consumer is not aware of what is happening to his bill. And it's a very latest bill, it's a June 2021 bill. KVRH is also significant, it is almost 15,000 units, when your KWH consumption is almost about 25,000 units. So significant component of KVRH is being consumed, and you also can understand that it is lagging KVRH, which means this consumer is having purely inductive loads. His power factor is not leading, his power factor permanently is lagging because there is no lead component at all. The lead component is completely zero. And going further, what is the KVH as a result of this? And you see there's a significant difference between the KWH and the KVH, almost a 5,000 unit difference. So your KWH is approximately 25,000, whereas the KVH is approximately 30,000 units. So as a result of that 15,000 units of KVRH, this consumer is paying 5,000 units of energy more, which converts to almost 50,000 rupees a month he's paying extra, which in my opinion is criminal, right? I mean, this is something which is a very simple thing to do, but it's the lack of either awareness or ignorance on the part of the consumer. And if you take this further to 12 months or more number of months, you find that is spread, and that story is being repeated every month on month. The billed power factor is almost lesser than 0.9 in almost every month. But interestingly, you also see that this consumer is being billed for a very high billing demand, as opposed to the the contract demand, as opposed to the actual demand that he's recording. His actual demand is much lower as compared to the contract demand that is being used to compute his billing demand, because his billing demand is a percentage of the contract demand. It's about 60% of the contract demand is being billed to him, whereas his actual demand that he's consuming is only 108. So this in itself is also a significant charge that he's paying, almost 80,000 rupees, as also paying for this 5,000 units approximately extra every month. So which means he's paying for almost something like 70 to 80,000 rupees on a monthly basis. And if we do a detailed analysis of his bill, you understand, using some of the tools that I'll speak to you in a bit, this is executive summary, you know, of what this consumer, particular consumer, can draw benefits from, understand from his bill. And what you see over here is that he has almost a potential of 6.5 lakhs of annual savings that are possible through his energy, through interventions being taken in his bill, through interventions in terms of contract demand reduction, through interventions in terms of installation of reactive power compensation systems. So that's the amount of savings that he can get, and the payback is almost just 1 year, sorry, 1 month. You know, you can discover that the actions to take up are one of the best investments you can make and offering even higher returns than your business in terms of return of capital employed, if I would call it that. So this is an example of analyzing the electricity bills by themselves. But if you have more data to support your case, you know, where you have already installed an energy management system, you already have a SCADA installed, or you have you're one of those where you have taken into account power quality metering also as part of your arsenal, as part of the infrastructure, then you can take up further more detailing, because the accuracy of the measurements, whatever measurements you are having in your facility coupled with electricity bills, can give you much more deeper insight, because you have a historical data analysis available of your data, depending on what locations you are collecting the data, right? And that can allow you to decide whether you need to go for a further study or not. So if you have such kind of situation, we at Efficient Energy, along with Asia Power Quality Initiative, which is promoted by International Copper Association, have built a tool, which is a common tool, which can allow to monitor, measure, and ensure power factor and harmonic compliance. Okay, it's a online tool which allows you to do a harmonics and power factor assessment online if you have the data of your electricity bills and the data of a very basic harmonics, available with you. So I'll just show you a quick video. It's a very small video to give you an idea of what this tool is all about. As you see on the screen, it requires certain parameters, your energy bill parameters, transformer capacity, impedance, and so on. And then once you enter that, it does some initial computations, some basic computations, after which it will ask you further more details about what is the actual current consumption, what is the actual voltage, what is the harmonics in your facility, if at all you have individual harmonics, if at all you know optionally true power factor and displacement power factor, if you have these figures. These are, some of them are, most of them are optional. If not, you can provide them as much as you know it. And if you provide these details, then it goes into further more computations to understand with respect to a estimated IEEE 519 2014 compliance. That's the standard which is utilized for harmonic regulations, which today most of the utilities in India are utilizing. And that standard is utilized. At the same time, state-specific tariff structures are also inbuilt into the tool, which allows to give you a summary report, which can be downloaded on the from that tool to give you an idea of first high-level, I would say, dipstick to understanding your particular facility, where it stands in terms of the compliance to harmonics, in terms of power factor and harmonics, how much you're losing, what is the additional KVH that you are paying for today as opposed to KWH, what is the ROI that you can expect. So we'll just see a couple of outputs from this tool. Just give me a second before I switch my screen here. Okay. So before I go into that, very quickly, what this tool essentially is bringing to, it's an online tool. We will share it in the chat for those whoever are interested in utilizing the tool. It is on APQI's website, Asia Power Quality Initiative's website, www.apqi.org. I request Amolji, if you can just kindly please put it in the chat for people whoever are interested to look it up. And what it essentially does is it brings a lot of benefits in terms of being industry neutral. It is not having any linkage with any particular brand or any particular OEM or anything. It's purely neutral in its sense. It's unbiased. It will allow you to identify whether or not you need to warrant and go further in terms of your power factor and harmonics, whether they are in a good enough zone, whether they're really poor, whether they're doing perfectly fine. You know, at certain times, you can just go and evaluate yourself, maybe at a certain frequency. It can give a good correlation between your harmonics and power factor, if there's resonance in your system and so on and so forth. And lastly, most importantly, actionable recommendations, you know, whether you need to go for mitigation solutions or not, whether you need to, what kind of solution you need to go for and so on. But remember, this is going to be a tool which is only utilizing your electricity bills and a snapshot of your harmonics at a point of time. This always practically may not be enough for most lot of industries. Okay, this is just, as I mentioned, a dipstick approach. It's a very initial teaser for you to understand where do you sit. If at all, you know, you are a SME who doesn't know where to go, whom to approach and so on, you can make use of this resource and understand where you sit before you go on into a more deeper study. And that's our step number four, to understand, you know, how should be, if at all, you know, now you have understood, either by taking the help of the tool or by yourself, you know that you have a complex system. You have a multi-transformer system installed. You have solar PV also, renewable energies also. You have import-export of power going on. Non-linear loads, you have significant number of them, variable frequency drives and so on. So you need to go for a comprehensive monitoring strategy, because a lot of the times the data is not at hand about your harmonics, right? You do not have data about harmonics, load current, TPF, DPF and so on, in which case this comprehensive monitoring plan you need to build. So here, what we recommend and we strongly suggest is to solve five problems with one action, right? So your monitoring plan should include not only only KVH point of view. It should go into energy, it should go into harmonics, it should go into reactive power, it should go into power quality, and most importantly, your existing reactive power systems, whatever reactive power compensation systems they are installed, they are monitoring also simultaneously. So you should be including, this plan should include the number of locations to be monitored, because you might have to monitor at the HT, you know, where you are being billed, where the tariff meter is being installed. Then you might need to go downstream on the transformer secondaries. Then how many locations you want to monitor simultaneously? That's a very important consideration that you need to have, because you do not want only one monitor to be installed for a particular period of time for 2 or 4 hours at your HT, then shifted to your LT, then shifted to different transformer, by which time your load pattern is changing. So you want simultaneous monitoring to be happening. Then the type and configuration of the analyzers to be deployed, you know, whether you can have them in-house, whether you have in-house analyzers or you have in-house meters already installed, which can be utilized, but coupled with more intelligence, more smart, you know, capabilities. Or you can, with the advent of technology today, remote monitoring has become a reality. There are portable solutions available which can just be shipped out to you. It can be remotely configured, it can be remotely monitored, and all you need to do is press a switch and it can start recording everything that you need. So does it have configuration analyzers? Also needs to understand, can it measure energy and demand in consonance with your energy bill? So your analyzer should be capable of having at least an equal or higher accuracy as compared to your energy meter. At the same time, the computational algorithms that it uses should be capable of mirroring your energy bill, your energy meters algorithms, and it should not be based on some simple averaging RMS or some such fundamentals. Next is whether it is having a four quadrant monitoring. That is another important factor, because it needs to understand import and export of reactive energy also. If at all you have, there are many situations, as I mentioned earlier, solar power being one of them, UPSs which are lightly loaded being another of them, LED lights, if they are significant percentage of your facility, they can also throw leading power factor into your facility. So these, all of these can play an important role in selecting the type and configuration of the analyzers that you need to select, because if you do not select the right ones, the monitoring will not give you the data that you need to take the decisions that will be required to go on further and select your right applications or the right compensation system that you will needing. Okay. Further on, if you take about including your reactive power compensation systems, you need to be aware that you need to monitor them simultaneously along with your mains. and your APFC or your capacitor panel systems or your harmonic filters or whoever, because it will give you a deeper insight, because you cannot switch them off for longer periods of time because you might incur a demand charge or so on. So this is the time to utilize all of these things. If you have your PQ analyzers, it's the time to put them to good use. But navigating this whole PQ monitoring, come analysis, come solutioning journey, it can seem daunting at times. Hence, our recommendation is to find the right partners who can leverage, who can help you leverage your existing systems and become a supplement to your resources. So before you decide on one quick solution, okay, this is what I would like to tell you, that it is, again, I'm recapping. It's the nature of the loads which plays a big role, unbalanced, fast changing, linear, non-linear, etc. Combined effect of all of them, a big role is your capacitors, automatic detune and so on, severity of harmonics and so on, and your performance of your load, nighttime, daytime, weekday, weekend and so on. So if at all you go for, as I mentioned, a product technology neutral approach is valuable, and we have many case studies where we can, you know, with a lot of pain, that we find a lot of times, not to name anybody, not to say anything negative, but OEMs a lot of times try to instill a fear factor, you know, coming from a horse's mouth, if at all you would believe, I did sell, as Amolji mentioned, harmonic filters and capacitor panels, a large part of my career initially. And I used to be a bad salesman, to be very honest, okay? Because 3 out of 5 of my customers, I used to tell them, you do not need a harmonic filter. You simply do not need a fast switching capacitor panel and so on and so forth, because the need was simply not there, or the ROI was very poor. So these kind of examples, what you see on the screen, you know, are very prevalent, which we find, where a neutral study can be costlier initially, but it can give almost, you know, 10 times the savings in terms of the solution that you would want to invest in and go further in investing. So what kind of approach this study should take? This advanced study, if I had called it the comprehensive monitoring plan, once you decide you are going to the study, you monitor at the PCC and various other locations. Minimum period should be a week is what we recommend. You do the data analysis using various platforms that you can have available. Secure is one of them, which I just showed you, and ensure you have a post-installation performance assessment built into your study. So you bind whoever is doing the study to come post the installation of the solution and do the assessment also. So one of the case studies which you are seeing on your screen is as a result of such a deeper study, where 4 key findings were highlighted. One, harmonics in terms of IEEE 519 2014 standards was almost 175% above the threshold. That was one big finding for prompting the customer to take some action, because utilities are coming up with harmonic regulations. Tamil Nadu is already there, regulations for 33 kV and above, 11 kV and 22 kV is coming very soon. Similarly, Maharashtra has implemented KVH billing, where harmonics is a subset of KVH already. So harmonics is playing a key role. The consumer is already 175% above the threshold. Next is the suggestion. What is the suggestion? Install detuned PF and a harmonic filter, which the cost of that is also provided as part of the report. What is the savings that can expect, and what is the ROI that they can expect? A 2.2 year ROI is a pretty good ROI, considering the life of these equipments are typically 5 to 8 years, you know, if you maintain them properly. So that's takes us to the next step of selecting the optimum solution, step number 5, because you need to prioritize based on the gaps of existing systems that are there, which can be filled in by the new systems. So most of the times we find a solution lie within your facility. A lot of times you have either an existing compensation system sitting and so on, and you can just do some retrofitting to improve that. Or you might have, I mentioned earlier 5 problems, right, in the first step, targeting 5 problems for monitoring simultaneously. What we need to do is, while you target these 5 problems in the earlier step, the solution also, if at all we are investing, should solve multiple issues at the same time. So think not only reactive power, but harmonic mitigation, compliance to future regulations also. You should buffer in the knowledge that your state utility or whoever's utility is going to come up with a tariff structure in the future. So ensure you tie in the solution that you're going to buy, right? Taking care of other power quality issues that may be a potential factor in reliability to your operations, which can be a voltage sag, which can be in the form of third harmonics, which can be in the form of unbalanced loading. So ensuring that your solution is taking care of not only just power factor correction or only harmonics, but taking a unified approach, a panacea approach to solve everything that is to do with reactive power, harmonics, unbalanced loading, fast changing loads, and so on. And having a technology vendor neutral mindset, that is important initially, before you finalize the solution. Do not get swayed by any particular vendor's technology, because there are dime a dozen technologies out there. It's only your need that needs to drive which you need to go for. So some solutions to just summarize, which are out there, available out there in terms of end use application. You have, as we mentioned, the first for plain inductive and capacitive loads, right? That's the first that you can speak about, where purely fixed inductors or capacitors are enough. I say inductors because, as I said, today leading power factor has also become a reality. And in some cases, we have had to go for inductive reactive power compensation, meaning we have to install inductors to solve the leading power factor problem. So that's the first one, which typically is for industries where there is not much variation. Then you have where the reactive power variation is significant, where you can go for either a automatic power factor correction system for minor changes in load, real-time power factor correction system where load variations are very fast, right, which is switching in the order of milliseconds. Or it can be a very, very stepless, or it can be, which is in industry parlance, it's called as a STATCON, or a SVG, you call it, static var generator, which can do a switching in a stepless fashion, inject as much KVR that is required. Further, for harmonic prone loads, you can go for an active filter or a passive filter, depending on the merits and demerits of the system. And or it can be just a simple detuned reactor, which is coupled in your capacitor panel, a 7% detuned filter for a generic broadband response, 5.67% for more specific tuned response to your harmonics and so on. And for unbalanced loads, it can be an unbalanced compensator. It can be either passive, it can be solid state, again a STATCOM, but with unbalanced compensation available. Now, but before you install any of the solutions, it is absolutely necessary to ensure it is technically sound, promising to eradicate the current KVH billing issues, right? And what another factor which I want to highlight over here is the approach should be purely based on the energy savings, but also considering the losses that that particular solution brings in. So for example, a simple reactive power compensation system or a solid state reactive power compensation system would be having a very low loss in terms of 0.5 watts per KVR, right? A 1000 KVR system, if you install, would give you only 0.5 kilowatt loss, so 500 watt for the entire system, which is very negligible, okay? But if you go for a harmonic reactor or a detuned reactor, that loss gets multiplied by 20 times, right? So a 1000 KVR system in the same, if you talk about, it will go into 10 kilowatt loss every hour that you're going to face. Even if you consider certain diversity, still a 5 kilowatt or a 6 kilowatt loss would be there. And that you multiply by 24 hours into 30 days and so on, it will work out to a significant loss. And going on to harmonic filters, active filters, okay, the loss even doubles or triples. These are some ballpark figures I'm just giving you. But what I want to highlight here is the fact of keeping that in mind about the losses in your mind is very important while you select the solution. So I think I'm running short of time. I've just about reached the end. The last is, as I mentioned, once the solution is selected, installed, post-performance verification of the solution. That is very important. Ensure that whoever is giving you the solution is giving you a complete ownership of the solution and the performance. Plan for minimal downtime. Integrate post-installation performance monitoring strategy. That is very important. And here, I would say, use the power of technology. Do not settle for anything less than 24/7 compliance, because you want to save energy every cycle. Remember the examples we saw in the vector diagrams. Every cycle counts. Every cycle is adding up your energy. So your compensation solution, your solution should be giving you every cycle compensation. It should be compensating for the reactive power or whatever unbalances or abrupt changes at every cycle, so that your KVH is optimized fully. And lastly, and going further beyond KVH, I would say today the current focus is KVH, power factor and harmonics we spoke about, but there is a whole lot of issues in the entire power quality or the electromagnetic zone, so as to speak, whereby I would say that let us ensure that our focus remains not only a short-term fix to remove penalties or to improvise or to optimize our KVH billing, but to add in our mindset facts about power quality issues such as disturbances, voltage sags, high frequency noise, which is coming as a part of your high frequency converters which are coming, earthing and grounding issues. All of these should become a part of our strategy to attack KVH as well as power quality in toto, and which will result in an improved life cycle and optimized energy utilization with continuous PQ, power quality monitoring. So I would like to thank you so much for bearing with me. Do excuse me if I went a little fast, and I think I'll open the floor to questions.